All right, folks, we'll go ahead and call this meeting to order. We'll start with a pledge to our flag and a quick moment of prayer. I'd like to ask you, if you've got a phone though, can I get you to check it to make sure it's silent, please? Okay? And if you would, just join me, please, with a pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Father, we come to you tonight, Lord, as we do, opening up every meeting, asking for your blessings, asking for wisdom and guidance. We thank you, Lord, for all of your continued blessings on our county and our country. I pray, Lord, that you'll watch over those in our community that have suffered loss. We've lost a number of them here in just the past week or so in our government family. I pray, Lord, that you'll just be with them in a special way. Guide our efforts here tonight, Lord. Let them be pleasing to you. Let us be respectful. Let us have good discourse here. Most important, Lord, is that anything that we do, we pray that it'll be pleasing to you. We ask this in your name. Amen.
All right, our first order of business, and we'll take these, we've got two sets of minutes. All were present for the September 30th meeting. So when you're prepared, we'll take a motion to approve those minutes.
So moved, Jim.
I have a motion to approve.
Second.
And a second. Any question or comments on that? Start the vote, Commissioner Allen?
Yes.
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 Okay. The meeting of October 7th, Commissioner Strickland, you were absent that night, so this is for the October 7th meeting, and when you're ready, we'll take a motion on that.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any comments or questions on that? With that, I'll go to Commissioner Bettis.
Yes.
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 Let's stay.
Very good. All right. So on occasion, we do have an opportunity to recognize some folks here. And I'm going to ask, in a minute, I'm going to read a proclamation, and I'll ask that the board vote to approve this proclamation. But before I read it, I'd like to recognize the Madison County 4-H Cowboys and Angels Equestrian Drill and Horse Quiz Bowl team. And what I'd like to do is ask Ms. Susan Goldman if you'd like to come up and tell us a little bit about these folks and their accomplishments.
Sure. There are 8 members of the team, plus there are 2 coaches. And you'll read that in just a little bit in the proclamation. But we were so thrilled to have these members as our 4-time national winning champions. They placed high at the regional contest, which allowed them to go to the national contest that was held in Unadilla this past year. And they had about 4 sets of items that they competed in there, and they were named as the national champions for that. Everywhere they go, they get recognized. They look so sharp, they do such a great job, and we are just thrilled that they are representing our county in the way that they are. Unfortunately, they are not able to be here tonight. 7 of them are working out of the 8, and then one of them, sadly, has some issues with their horse tonight. So I apologize for them not being able to be here. I think Lee received a phone call from them tonight, but I know a lot of their practice time is spent at Danson Tree Farms, that's really close by.
That's right.
In his district, and they just work extremely hard, and we are so proud of them. Mm-hmm. Great group of people.
And please pass on to them that we are in no way offended. I know that they have things to do too. So, What I would like to do is if you'll permit me, though, is just take a minute and read this proclamation. And again, this is Madison County 4-H Cowboys and Angels, equestrian drill and horse quiz bowl teams. Whereas one of many points of pride in Madison County 4-H is the knowledge that many students have gained from earning national and regional awards through participation in horse competition. The equestrian drill team, consisting of an 8-member group of riders and horse quiz bowl high score, consisting of one individual. And whereas this past year, the equestrian drill team was named Southeast Mounted Drill Team Association Region Champions in 4-H and open competitions, and placed first in the state competition in quad 4-H, quad theme, and theme 4-H competitions. Whereas the equestrian drill team was named the 2019 SEMTA Freestyle Open 4-H theme and 4-H quad theme national champions, and were also 4-H FFA and open national division champions as a result of cumulative high scores throughout the entire season. And whereas the Madison County 4-H Cowboys and Angels drill team members are Rihanna Adams, Katie Griffin, Avery Hardwick, Lindley Hawks, Samantha Holston, Taylor Lester, Mackenzie Seagraves, and Cadence Wright. And whereas team coaches are Meredith Hawks and Scott Hawks. And whereas this past year, after winning at the state 4-H horse quiz bowl and placing second at the regional horse quiz bowl contest, the horse quiz bowl team competed at the national Western Roundup horse quiz bowl contest in Denver, Colorado. And whereas horse quiz bowl team members Tess Branion, Tori Branion, Bethany Lace, and Sophia Merka won second at the National Western Roundup Horse Quiz Bowl Contest in Denver, Colorado. And whereas the team was led by team coach Shannon McBride and Captain Sophia Merka. And whereas Sophia Merka was named as the high individual out of the National Horse Quiz Bowl competitors, and whereas these outstanding accomplishments benefit Madison County's rank as one of Georgia's top agriculture counties and continues its proud tradition of excellence in youth achievement. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Board of Commissioners of Madison County hereby congratulates these dedicated team members, coaches, and expresses its sincere appreciation for their hard work and commitment. So resolved by Madison County Board of Commissioners on this 28th day, October 2019. Yes.
And we do have members of the horse quiz bowl team represented today. When you called me up, you said equestrian drill team.
I'm sorry. Yeah, it was to recognize both. So if you'd like to introduce those members, we
would
like
to.
Okay.
We have Tess Branion in the back of the room, and Tess is. Come on up, Tess. Tess is in the 12th grade. She's a graduating senior this year, and she well represented the team. If you stand up. Stand up. There you go. And then we also have Sophie Merka, who is here. And Sophie is running from one event to another event. And Sophie was, as it stated, the high individual out of how many?
I believe there are 44.
44 wow. Participants on the national awesome. Level, and she was wow. at least 30 points above them. And then Tori Branion, who is at college today, she was also at least 11 points above most of the competitors. They were both seventh high individuals, so they did awesome. We are so proud of them, and thank you so much for representing our county in this way.
Yeah, we'll still have to vote real quick. And she's got some, hey, Susan, she does have the proclamation. And let's see, Sophie.
Yes.
Really nice style points. You didn't correct me on your name. I appreciate that.
No, it's fine. I didn't hear anything.
Okay. I was just amazed that one of the ladies was shy after competing at the national level. You're afraid to stand up in front of this room. So,
to be fair, she was facing ahead of everybody. You can really see the audience.
Well, we sure appreciate it. And what I'd like to do is I'd ask the board for a vote to approve this proclamation.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Commissioner Kirk.
Yes.
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 Very well done. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. It's nice to be able to start a meeting off on a real positive note, too. So, and if you're really, really lacking anything else to do, you can stay. Or if you'd like to leave us, I know y'all got a lot of things to do, but now would be a good time if y'all wanted to make your exodus. We'll give you a few. There you go.
Thank you so much.
Yes. All right. Thank you. Okay, that's good stuff. I have nothing on the chairman's report tonight. We'll move right into statements and remarks then from citizens on any agenda item. We have four agenda items tonight. Those items listed 5 through 8, consider accepting Republican Party nominee Ralph Hudgens to fill a vacant position on the Board of Elections. We're going to consider 2019 budget amendments dated October 7th, 2019. We'll take those in a consent agenda when we get to it. And then we have two other items. Consider our 2020 LMIG projects, local maintenance improvement grant projects. And lastly, to consider filling a vacant industrial development billing authority position. So if anybody's here that would like to speak on those four items tonight, we'll open the floor up for you. No? All right, we won't delay. So our first actual two items are the Republican Party nominee position. And Mr. Hudgens, we met at our previous meeting, and it was introduced that you were going to be the nominee of the Republican Party to fill that position. Mr. Mike Mathis resigned, I believe it was last month. And I'm going to do is, and then we have our second item is to consider our budget amendments. These are consent items on our agenda, folks. The board felt, as we discussed them, that among them, there was very little discussion or nothing that had been left uncovered. And at this point, what I'll do is entertain a motion to consider accepting these two consent agenda items.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments on either of those two?
I think he's well qualified.
He knows a thing or two.
It'd be nice if he had a little more experience.
Can I say something?
Let me take a vote real quick, right. And that way you can't back out after we vote.
No backing out.
Our vote will start with Commissioner Doster.
Yes.
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 Now, yes, sir.
I just wanted to say that this is the first time I've ever been up for election. I didn't have a single vote against
me. Yeah. I wonder what that feels. Okay. Well, we sure appreciate your willingness to be on the board, too. All right. Our next item is to consider our 2020 LMIG road projects. You have a listing of those that I believe Alan spoke with you at the last meeting. And what I'll do is we'll just open it for a motion, and then if you want to discuss, and the motion would be to approve it as presented. Jones Chapel Shiloh Road, Rogers Mill Road, and Bullock Mill Road to be resurfaced. Combined cost on those, plus we have some work that has been done that goes towards a match. The total on that was about almost $1.1 million. The state granted us $820,000, the county matching almost a quarter of a million, $246,000. So we will be at least entertaining these in a motion. If you have anything different than that, then we'll amend it and you can discuss that as well. So with that, I'll open it. Motion to approve Element Project List. Sorry.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Okay, now, any comments, discussion on these items here, or are there different thoughts?
Mr. Chairman, I'm not opposed to any of the roads that we've shown. I guess my only comment or request is if Broken Department could get us kind of a top 10 list of things that they're looking, that they feel are the following priorities, I'd like to go ahead and get those, start looking at those.
I agree 100%. I agree. We're looking at things now, trying to put together that plan, and I regret that I got sidetracked a little bit and did not complete that, but it is a very good idea. Any other comment or concern on that? If not, the vote and the second is to approve the 2020 Element Project List. Commissioner Allen?
Yes.
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 All right, very good. All right, our last item is to consider filling vacant industrial development and building authority position. The Board of Commissioners recently met and considered a number of applicants for a vacant position. The position was filled at that time with Ms. Pat Mahoney, and there was one other gentleman that was considered heavily in that discussion too. What I'll do is at this point I'll open the floor up for motion. If the board has a recommendation on who they would appoint to that position, and a second on that.
I make a motion that Mark Berry be put in that position.
I second.
So we have a motion and a second to consider Mark Perry to fill that vacant position. And for the, again, having been through a vetting process before and very recently on that, I think the board is comfortable with what they learned about Mark. And also, Mark has agreed if selected, he would fill that position. So any comment or any further discussion on that position?
I'd like to make a comment if you don't mind, Chair.
Please.
You know, these positions are very important, and going forward, you know, I just want everyone, all the citizens, to know that when they see these things come open, because it is in the papers, that was in the paper, you know, and they want to be a part of that, maybe want to get in that position, make sure that you know, reach out to your commissioner, reach out to the chairman, reach out to the IDA and let them know that you are interested so you can, you know, be a part of this process. Because we do want to make sure that we're inclusive of everyone and make sure everyone knows that there's an opportunity maybe to serve the county in this capacity. So I would just want to make sure that everyone knew that, you know, just to make sure that they know their opportunities out there. Thank you, Chair.
Fair enough. Any other comment? Question? Okay.
Just to appreciate him serving, and I know he'll do a fine job.
I believe so too. Motion and second to approve Mark Perry for the vacant position. The vote is to Commissioner Strickland.
Yes.
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 All right. We have no new business tonight. Aside from the three roads that you just approved for consideration for Hellmaker, is there any updates that any of you have, or any concerns that you have with any road that you may or may not have mentioned?
Not particular road, but could you refresh my memory on our anticipated schedule for the road safety grant?
So the off system,
yes,
the off system safety grant, we're awaiting word. We submitted an application, and I think and I have to refer back to Alan on this. as we have in the past, is they give us kind of a target amount, and we usually, we oversubmit. And the value in that is sometimes if we're competing with other counties and they don't submit anything for consideration, then we have in the past been awarded some of that. So I'm trying my best to remember when that gets awarded. It's usually, I think it, last year was before the end of the year, so that gives us at least the next 2 months, but I'm not, I think their intent is to approve these projects so that their contract can be let and they can be doing them in the spring and summer of next year. So I'll see if I can follow up on that.
The crossroads of Urban Kirk and New Haven Church Road, it grows up from time to time, but right away, we had one fatality there, so I've had some interest in cutting that down. And New Haven.
Right before you dump out on 98. Okay. Got it. Anything else? If you haven't been in that part of the county, the intersection of 174 and 96, 106, 174 and 106, state, since those are two state highways, there was a near fatal accident a few months back at that intersection. It was a merging lane, very similar to what you see at Nice Commerce and 106. The angle is such that you have limited sight distance looking, and at least at Nice Commerce, when you're looking back to the north, pulling out of Nice Commerce. So the state actually took the option away at that intersection, and you now have to come in at a perpendicular angle so that you have equal sight distance in both directions. It eliminates, in this particular accident this last time, everybody wonders how it's very, very common for certain vehicles, whether it's a van or a utility vehicle of some sort that does not have windows. And if you pull up to that stop sign there, as it was, you literally can't see down that road as it merges onto or into the road that you're in. So again, they took away the option of coming in at that steep an angle, and you have to come to a 90 degree approach angle on that road. So we're looking at asking, I don't know what kind of support we get from the state, because we have several of those, Nice Commerce being one of them. But it is a county road as opposed to two state roads. So we have to, we may have to shoulder, this may be one of those things you mentioned in the top 10 or whatever, that the county has to put a little skin in the game and see if we can get some of their assistance. And
Commissioner Bettis also has a state route with a county road as well. Don't you, with a bad intersection? Don't you have any business? I was thinking you had, there was one more that you were talking about.
There are several. Friendship Church Road, that ends on 98, or it comes out on 98, very similar to that approach angle. Gosh, I don't know if that's the right term, but you know, I mean, it's the...
Tell us that's right,
though. Is it? Okay. Angle of incidence. I like that one better. But that is the exact same case that you're having to look across a vehicle, and you hope that you can see through windows and stuff like that. And it's not a good situation, and so we're looking at those again. They have a safety concern about them, so I'm asking the state to help us a little bit on that if they throw some money our way. Anything else? Urgent matters? No. All right, statements and remarks from citizens. Folks, we'll open the floor for any comment or statements that any of you'd like to make. I'm guessing that y'all only come here to hear about these four items. So what I'd ask is if you have comments of any nature, they don't have to be on anything we've spoken about tonight, but you're to open the floor. We typically ask that you try to keep your comments brief, and our policy actually says limit it to 3 minutes. unless you're just really comfortable speaking in front of a mic, sometimes 3 minutes seems like about 13 seconds. So I just ask that you take your time, tell us what you want, but appreciate this too. It's an opportunity for you to speak. It's not necessarily an opportunity for commissioners to respond. And that's so that we're not arguing with you and we're not cutting your time off or doing anything. We're gonna just give you the opportunity to make a comment or statement, anything you wanna make. You could try to keep names and, you know, profanity out of it. That's greatly appreciated. We do take this, so. And with that, I'll open the floor. When you approach, if you give me your name and an address. Come on. Name and address and then speak your mind.
Good evening. My name is Gina Ward. I live at 1709 Wagoners Grove Church Road, and I'm quite sure you all know why I'm here. I would first like to go ahead and can I just hand this to you, Commissioner Doster, and you pass it out? Just some information. I made 6 copies if you're interested in just a little bit of the research. It's more inclusive reading than I'm putting in my statement this evening. I am bringing my concerns before the board tonight in the hopes that you, our Board of Commissioners, will listen and take action. We feel a price tag has been put on our head, our health, our quality of life. We ask that you defend us and not GRP. You are the governing body of this county, and we desperately need your help. The first issue is the noise. It has been 4 months, and it is not quieting down. I read the Noise Effects Handbook, the whole thing, published by the Office of Noise Abatement and Control, a division of the EPA. And all of the symptoms and side effects mentioned in the handbook are on the chart that I handed out to you. In August, I appeared before the board and requested you to not amend the noise ordinance. You amended it with no explanation other than housekeeping. The noise that we are subjected to in the middle of the night is endangering our health. We have absolutely no recourse at this point. I ask the board to intervene on our behalf and put an end to the after-hour disturbances. Next, I want to tell you what I have learned about what they are burning. In the beginning, they said that they would burn C and D, construction and demolition. In my research, I have found that this is worse than the railroad ties. A study for the EPA revealed that only 10% of C and D is actually blue. Pick a poison if you may: asbestos, asphalt shingles, mercury, PVC plastics, sulfur-containing gypsum, paint, and adhesives are a few of the toxic materials found in C&D waste. The scariest ingredient that they have in their waste so far is CCA. It's chromated copper arsenic. That's, you know what it is. Pallets are made of it. Pallets are made of it. It has the greenish tint to it. If so much as 1% of CCA is found in the ash, the whole load of ash is considered toxic and must be disposed of in a proper way. It is the most dangerous pollutant to air and water supplies because of how easily it can leach into our water and land. Even slash from, everybody knows how bad it is to burn railroad ties, and that's all I'm gonna say. Even slash from forestry has toxic compounds. Our trees absorb pollutants when burned, and they release them back into the air. Toxins regularly found in trees include mercury, lead, cadmium, copper, iron, and zinc, just to name a few. A comparison of air permit limits shows that biomass burners are being permitted to allow 50% more nitrogen oxide, 500% more volatile organic compounds, 90% more particulate matter, material, the stuff that's falling on all of y'all, And 25% more carbon monoxide than coal power plants per unit of energy. My information, I can cite it to you after the meeting if you want to know where I've received this. In a 2002 Wall Street Journal analysis, it was found that 80% of U.S. biomass incinerators have been cited for air and water violations. Lastly, we fear for our water supply. I know that there have been problems here in the county and bigger problems in Franklin County. In my conversations with the EPD, I was told that they have only one system in place for wastewater right now. They refer to it as a settling pond, where the wastewater will evaporate. 780,000 gallons of water a day, on a good day, I got that from the IDA meeting, just evaporating. I know that they have applied for an NPDES, a permit that will allow them to pump wastewater into our creeks. And it is just a matter of time before my well is probably going to be poisoned. There are several natural springs nearby the plant that feed into the creek on my property. The creek has been a treasure hunt for generations, full of Native American arrowheads, pottery, and the remnants of stills. So once again, I'm appealing to you to protect our right to clean water. So my question to you is, why do we, the citizens, feel like you are protecting this plant and not us? Thank you for your time.
Thank you all for your service. And second, I want to commend Commissioner Allen for clarifying about the importance of those two positions. And that I hope, you said you don't have to answer me, but I hope you do answer me. I have a question that those positions are being considered. So that means they're not. Those people have not been chosen yet.
Which, are you talking about the position tonight on the IDA?
I'm talking about the Republican Party.
Oh, the Republican Party.
And the other.
Yeah, the only position that was considered tonight was the Republican Party position. The
other one was already approved.
That's correct. That's, yeah.
Okay. So the other one for the Board of Elections, someone else can come forth.
Right. They can, when they serve a term. And when that term is at its either expiration or that the individual resigns, then they will look to appoint a new one. They make a recommendation to this board, and this board approves it.
Okay, and they're being chosen through a process?
As far as that's the chairman or chairperson of the Board of Elections is appointed by the Superior Court. They do not fall under this board. I've had them make that very clear to me. So.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you don't appoint them? You have to
vote. We appointed. What I'm saying is their recommendation is what I'm saying. They make that recommendation.
But you would consider someone else that they come for. That's what I'm saying.
Sure.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And second, I do live near that plant, and I'm standing with my neighbors that, you know, it concerned me when the smoke went from white to black when they start burning those tires. So I hope you all please take in consideration what the community is asking for. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Drago Tosanovich. I live on 959 Highway 172. I have a list of things to go over about the plan also, but Gina has covered most of them. But the thing I feel is like I was lied to about the plant, and it bothers me. You know, I was told it would just be water vapor, and today there was black smoke coming out of there, and I know that water vapor is not black smoke. There's some particulate matter in that smoke that's falling back down on us.
So what I was told was it was a clean energy producing plant, and it's really not. So I was worried about that. It's the same with the railroad ties. They had a permit to operate, or in C&D, which Gina pointed out, is not necessarily a good fuel either. It sounds good when it's presented, but it's not as pollution-free as they say. But the railroad ties to me were a complete surprise. They could have decided to leave their permit the way it was and not burn railroad ties, but instead they put their bottom line over all of us, the people of the county, so there'll be even more particulate matter coming out of the stacks, including the surrounding area. So it's another place where I felt they lied to me directly and to all of us. And as soon as they had a chance to alter what they were going to do, they did it, regardless of the way we felt. She mentioned the water quality and a number of things. There was a spill in Franklin County at this plant that's identical to ours. It killed some fish from the nearby stream. You know, this could happen here. So I have no faith in this company for telling me what they're going to do. Obviously. And there was a quest for you guys to get more involved on behalf of the people you represent. And I think that's great. The other thing I would like to see is there's this tax windfall, and we are all happy about having a little more money to spend. And I understand that, you know, but some money should be set aside now to help the people that are directly impacted by this overcome these problems the plant has produced. You know, I don't know, I could ask all of you, like, did you sleep with your window open last night? It was a cool night. Did you hear the windows open? And are any of you directly impacted by the plant? You know, I have to close my windows at night now because the noise from the plant bothers me enough that it's hard to just go to sleep like I used to with the sound of Madison County out the window. And I know they're operating, the zoning was in place and all that, but I still think they need to take some action. And they keep saying they will, but I don't necessarily believe that to be true anymore. You know, they might do a couple of cosmetic things to help out, but I really think it's important that you guys commit yourself to helping the people that are impacted. And I think you should take some of that windfall tax money and start setting it aside where if we need audio engineers or water testing on our own, you know, to disprove what might be coming from the plant, that we have a fund set up to help correct the things that could possibly go wrong right at the plant. Because it's difficult for citizens to raise that money, but a little bit of that tax windfall can be held, you know, in a, you know, protected Madison County fund, so it's available if needed. The other question somebody asked me on the railroad ties, and you guys may have an answer, are they buying these ties to burn for fuel, or are they getting paid to take this hazardous waste and burn it at their plant? Because the pile at the plant is bigger and bigger every time we go by there. And now the railroad cars are coming in full of ties. So I just wonder, I know it's a bottom line issue with them, but are they actually getting paid to dispose of this hazardous waste? You know, and again, if I were you, I wouldn't trust them either. So thank you very much.
All right, sir. Thank you. Anybody else like to speak?
My name is Benjamin Gossett. I live in Collier as well, and I'm concerned about the cross ties, especially. I did a little reading up on what is creosote. Creosote is a pesticide, and when you burn it, it can cause cancer. And if we look at the cancer effects of the residue coming out of the plant, that residue is getting on the plants, the cattle is going to be eating, and we're going to be breathing. So I would like to ask that we get with Georgia Environmental and have a clean air study of the area around the plant, get a baseline of where the air quality is now, and if they continue to burn it, this stuff, we have a running way of measuring the toxic acid in the air. Because right now, this, I don't know if you guys have fought cancer, but I have. And I spent a lot of time in Emory. And I don't, it's not a pleasant feature to go around there and look at the people that are fighting cancer. So I would like to offer that as a suggestion get a baseline of air around the plant at a quarter of a mile, a half a mile, and a mile out. That's the only way we're gonna be able to see what is really coming out. We need the particulate mass coming out of it, and we need to know what the air quality is now versus what it's gonna be as we continue to go along this road.
Is there anybody else that would like to speak?
Without going back up, because I said my name, I just want to add that mile out, I live a mile and a half away. I know people in Overlook County who live 5 or 6 miles away who have the same problems we've heard tonight. So it's not limited to right there. This is a widespread problem in the county now.
I remember when Gatlinburg was on fire and we dealt with that here, so I appreciate that it doesn't have to be local as we define, whatever, however we define local, so I appreciate that. Anybody else like to speak? Yes,
Mr.
Scarborough. Oh my goodness.
Mr. Scarborough, I'd like to speak last. I'd like to reserve the opportunity to speak last if that's okay.
Anybody else like to speak?
I just want to say, just a smile. I can't even touch the surface with these guys. Yeah. See it.
My name is Ted Fowler. I live at 1965 HB Channel Road. And I just want to back up about the noise. I measured 80 decibels Sunday morning at one point. So if it's 80 decibels, that was at one point, not all the time. If it's 80 at my back porch, what is it at their perimeter? So the noise is another problem as well as the pollution. And I wanted to touch on the road you were talking about. I drive a tractor trailer some, and big farm tractors. I almost witnessed my cousin get hit up 106 and Old Wild Road. It's very limited, the access. The fight is very limited to your left going back 4 miles. Mm-hmm. You almost got hit right there. Because you can't see when you're on the tractor.
All right.
There's several areas in the county like that. And I just wanted to back up what she was saying about the noise and the problems with the road.
Okay. I appreciate that too. Anybody else? Parting shots? All right.
I didn't come here tonight to speak, but I thought I'd take the opportunity now to be here. I just can't get enough of this during the month in the Oval community, so I want to come back and share the love with you guys. See, it's not a whole lot different here than it is there. First of all, I want to tell y'all I do appreciate what you do. I really appreciate what you do. And I do want to speak a little bit on behalf of the plan over there. It is, you know, I'm the chairman of the Board of Commissioners in Overcoat County, and I too have fielded some complaints about that. Obviously, there's nothing I can do, but I was curious to see what kind of interest you guys had. So I want to mention that. But finally, I just want to tell you too that how much I appreciate your cooperation with us with the MOAS. I know we all handed up a little bit more this year, and we did that, I feel like, on the right way and getting together. And Lisa and John, I appreciate you guys. And I know some of you couldn't make it, but sitting down, negotiating eye to eye, face to face, and working out a resolution the way it ought to be worked out. I just want to tell you, I appreciate that. Thank you, Mark.
Thanks, sir. Thank you. Well, we'll go ahead and consider that section closed, but I would like to, not to challenge anybody. We're mindful that it's again, it's an opportunity for people to speak their mind and say what they feel. All your concerns are valid. I'm not in the business of knowing. on exactly everything. Certainly, as conditions change. What I will tell you, though, is there is, hopefully, there will be an opportunity soon. Soon as in weeks, not months or years. That the plant manager, gentleman named David Groves, is going to open up the site, both locations, but he said that he would make them available for tours, if you, you know, for people to come up and look. And what I really want, the reason I mentioned David Groves' name is, rather than you get secondhand information from me, I'd rather you talk to them. I'd rather them provide you with exactly the regulatory requirements that they operate under, how they got it. Many times, contrary to popular belief, we don't really get to negotiate many things with EPD, good, bad, or indifferent. It gets handed to us for the most part. So I want to make sure that everybody's voice is clear. I have heard, and again, please, if you have the opportunity, speak to Mr. Groves. Ask them about noise or pollution abatement procedures or practices, because in the very short time he's been at the helm, very short time, he's already heard very much what you guys are saying here tonight. What I'll tell you, though, is I heard words like, you know, baffles and barriers and things like that that would reduce the noise level. They're hearing that, and these are the kinds of things that I think the county can enter into discussions with. So just stay tuned. They are not, and he said that the tours and everything would be in a couple of weeks, and I asked him why in a couple of weeks. They're not, for those that live near this plant, you're well aware that they're not in, they've been going up and down, mm-hmm. They've, in other words, they've been identifying issues, correcting them, and within the, and I could ask those in the audience that perhaps have a lot better information about the particular operation at the plant. What I'm telling you, I'm passing on what I heard Friday morning, once they enter to a steady state, is it gonna reduce the pollutants? I don't know how it can reduce pollutants if it's at a steady state. It'll be whatever it is at a steady state at that point. What you might see an improvement on there, though, are the noise levels. As they stop doing these startup, they have to do certain things when they do pressure checks and purge these lines and everything. And that's a large source of the really loud, abrupt noises. So you may see, hopefully you'll hear some relief on that. But again, David Groves, as we get word when they're up and running as a county, I would be more than happy to put that word out that you're more than welcome to contact him or his folks down there and go see this place and do ask the questions directly to them. A lot of people in the business, there are a lot of people that are in the business of building and designing and selling something. It gets very different for the gentleman or the lady that has to actually run it. So they're pretty keen on not wanting to live in a hostile environment. So I think you'll get your best information from those folks. And with that, all I need is a vote.
Mr. Chair, I'd like to add a comment that I was surprised on some of the permitting issues that EPD doesn't run. Their ad in the local paper, like some legal organs are required or legal procedures are required. And I say that just to encourage you to. EPD's got on their website, you can sign. I signed up for it the other week when I kind of found out about it. You can sign up for email notifications on water, land, and air adjustments to the code.
Inspections and stuff, or just change of policy.
It's policy changes, that's how they put that out. So I know it's maybe behind the scenes now, but
right.
That's how they're operating in this new digital age. So I encourage people to look on that website to be informed. And with that, I'll make a motion to adjourn.
I have a motion, second.
Second.
We Commissioner Allen?
Yes.
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 Yes. We're adjourned, folks. Thank you very much. We're adjourned. We're adjourned.